But let's continue with the second part. Before we start to talk, just a quick recap for the Angular camp on the beginning of July in Barcelona. We had some interesting discussions and conversations in the break, where it came, for example, up to the flight price. And as you can see, the cheapest flights in the state are from 88 euro to, I don't know, you can spend even more if you want and if you need to go there by first class. What I wanted to say is give it a try, take a look on angularcamp.org and come to us in July.
See you there.
I've prepared no slides, so you will see a lot of code. I will just introduce and give you some insights about our transition from and migration from Angular 1 to Angular 2. So migrating from Angular 1 to Angular 2 is not a question which you can answer in general. It depends on the context. So if you, for example, or I will tell you of our case, like we had some concerns and started thinking about it in general on the project at November 2015, yeah, last year. And our main concerns was about the maintainability, like, and also the scaling of the development team. Like, we started, I think, with two guys on the front end. And right now there are even more, I think 4 or 5, something like that. So some concerns were like, how can we teach some new guys, new developers, which has no experience with AngularJS, with Angular 1, like, should we introduce them in Angular 1 or Angular 2? This was one concern. The second concern was, or one of the second reasons was, our going live date. Like, we are doing quarterly releases for our customer now. Like, internally we're doing continuous deployment. So one of those concerns were we are going live at the end of 2016, so we have a lot of time. We started using Angular 2 and migrating when it still was in beta 7 or something like that. Like, now, last week, the first release candidates were announced, so it's going to be even closer and more stable, especially the APIs. That was another concern. And our main reason why we decided finally to migrate was, like, the maintainability and the improved performance, like, on development, on testing, and the performance of Angular 2 itself compared to Angular 1, and how you transfer all this knowledge to your new teammates which are just started using Angular. So that's why we decide using Angular 2 there, because the main concepts of Angular 2, so who is using Angular 2, by the way? Using it in production or just playing around? In production? 1, 2, 3 guys? Nice. So I think later on we should do the Q&A session. I think this is giving more benefit instead of just showing code. So I will show some main concepts. I will not go into the details. I will show our pitfalls and will ask the others, the other Angular 2 production users, about their pitfalls. And I think this will be an interesting discussion. And another thing is, if you have any questions, just shout it out and do it and interrupt me. So let's start. I will make this bigger. How does this work? Should be command plus, right?
The name in the settings.
Yes, exactly.
Yeah. Okay, I will just show for a demo case. Yeah. the bootstrap file and a basic component, and we'll go into details of some pitfalls. So first of all is our main entry points, like the Angular 1 application was developed in TypeScript, using all these benefits with running on Webpack, like as a package and magic handler for running the tests, doing live reloading, packing the application, building it, and so on. So here you can see, as a quick overview, our bootstrap file of Angular, of our Angular 1 application. So it can be divided like in loading and importing all the needed resources. And then there we have the configuration. And here the funny thing is starting on Angular 1, like bootstrapping the application. So we need to preload all the depending modules and then tell Angular, yeah, this is the main module with all those dependencies. Those dependencies, yeah, we just defined them here. So here you can see all those dependencies. And then we run through the config phase, setting some URLs there, adding an exception handler, and doing some other configuration stuff till we can run the application. Okay, now let's see how this is this will look like in the Angular 2 version. In order to get a better like feeling how what will change and how what things will look different in the Angular 2 version. Okay, in the Angular 2 version, yeah, it's also based on TypeScript. You have also all the imports, and then we define our main application, but as I see now, this is the wrong file, I need the main TS file. Yeah, here we have all our imports as well. Here this is changes like, is it in production mode or in development mode, where we tell Angular to enable the prod mode, and here we define some other variables like if it's in development mode. That's like, yeah, just an easy going thing. Oh fuck. I will turn the Wi-Fi off. And here, finally, we bootstrap our application. So the bootstrap itself is just a function call, call it bootstrap, where the first parameter is your main application, like your main component. So I think, or who does not know what a component is in the Angular 1 or Angular 2 way? Please raise your hands.
Who doesn't know?
Like, should I explain it? Or is it clear?
It's clear.
Okay. Then I'll continue. So our first parameter is like the main entry point, like the main component. And here we define all our providers. And providers, you can compare them like with, similar to the config phase, which is defined and later on provided within Angular 2's dependency injection mechanism. Here we provide, for example, all our form providers, M providers, or the HTTP providers in order to interact with my backend. These are some custom providers, and we can also define some providers or pre-define some settings for the providers. For example, the system config should use this parameter here, or what is more interesting is here, for example, where we define how our token looks like, which is sent as a header parameter on each API request. This is totally different compared to Angular 1, where you defined your how it is called? I did too much Angular 2, can't remember on Angular 1 version. Had to take a look. Yeah. You use the providers for doing this in Angular 1. In Angular 2 it's a bit tricky because you have only one bootstrap phase
without those different config sections and where it gets wired automatically, and there is a lot of magic, so here you do it more explicitly. And here, for example, I define provide the HTTP auth, like register it in the DI mechanism, and use those parameters like to start it. And when we take a closer look in the HTTP, in the auth HTTP class, we can see here in the constructor, we use the options, the HTTP, and the router parameters. And those are getted injected. Close it. Those are getting injected here, and here I can define some mock objects as well, therefore. But let's go on. I don't want to bore you with going line by line through it. So after our bootstrap is done, we just get back a promise where we can react on it, or like catching errors as well. In this case, I'm just logging errors to the console. Okay, let's go to the front end. So the Angular 1 version and Angular 2 version used Webpack as a package manager. On the new version, we just have the serve local script, which, as you can see here, just starts the Webpack dev server with all the configuration in it. I think that's not that important, or if you want, I can go into it as well. But in general, I compile all the TypeScript files, I run my style checkers, till I finally add some customized stuff. For example, in this case, we are trying to use a mock server, like in order to be not that depending on the backend, in order to use it as a separate application.
Does it have hot reloader?
It includes the hot reloader as well, yeah.
That's cool.
So this is an out-of-the-box thing. Therefore, what was important, and I think it's important to share it as well, like the base for our Angular 2 application was not like everything was customized, therefore we used the Angular 2 Webpack starter kit. It's a GitHub repository which you can use and modify as you want it. So we took this as a base for our Angular 2 application, and later on we throw out some stuff which we definitely don't need, or we customize, for example, our test setup. And yeah, it was a good base in order to start immediately with it. And you also have no no problems, for example, how to implement a style checker for TypeScript, how to do all this linting stuff, like how to deal with SCSS or packing it and doing the whole package mechanism for testing or production. Therefore, this is already included in the Angular 2 Webpack starter repository, and it's definitely a good base to start an application with it. Okay, the dev server is running, so now we can see. I will start it in the Angular 1 version as well. And here we can see our login. I'm not allowed to show that much details because it's the application of a customer, but let's go through it and take a look at the source code. The source code of our Angular 2 application looks like this. We have defined our title and some meta tags, and that's finally it. And here we define our main entry point, like our application component. The good thing about this here, for example, is that we don't have to care about this because Webpack is doing this. So the plain index.html file in the editor looks like this. That's it finally. And I can hand over Webpack all the information. I can also do some if-elses here in the code for defining some configuration options. And Webpack is handling this for me. okay, this is the Angular 2 version, and Angular 1 version should run as well. This looks similar, but here we see some differences. For example, the title. For the title, we are using ng-bind, so that's one of the also main changes, which is not that visible. But Angular 1 affected the whole HTML, therefore, and Angular 2 affects only those things which are happened in the body. So in Angular 2, for example, if we want to change a title, you have to use their provided class, therefore, and just set it directly with the DOM, with the document object model in your code. So there is no templating option, therefore, anymore. Okay, next steps. So what was a pain was, for example, the routing stuff. In Angular 1, it was like app.ts. I will show the Angular 2 version of it. So we are still using Angular 2, the latest beta version of it. Not the first release candidate version, because there were some major changes in the router. Yeah, some of you guys know it. Okay, here we also see our main component. Like a quick went through it. Here we define our annotation, where we say this is the selector, these are the dependencies, and this is the router outlet where all this router magic happens. And under it, I have my route config, where I define my paths and which components to get and display when this is selected. And as a last wildcard, we have just a redirect if no route is matching, redirect him to the pricing route. And this is handled by the Angular router, therefore, like when I'm typing in and going to the login, which we can see here. Angular 2 is just displaying the login component. And here we can define some custom data. This was one learning as well, but I will point to it later. Here we have our login component, and what we can see here is like the heavy usage of Angular components there. So we splitted this login component because we wanted to reuse, for example, the login container to display the password forgotten form as well, or defining other stuff. So this is just the wrapper around it. And the login form, which you can see here, is simply the login form. And we can easily exchange it when we implement the password forgotten form with our password forgotten component. So we have heavily reusage of components. And components, by the way, should be separated into smart components and dump components. I will give you an example of a dump component, which we can find on the login form. We can go into the template, and here we have, for example, a dump component, which is just a button. And the button component looks like this. We have the different configuration options, and it's just for displaying the aggregated or computed data, therefore.
So for dummy components, you mean stateless?
Stateless components or dump components in an UI point of view, for example, like the buttons. I can use them as well, like defining them with custom classes and other things. But the advantage, therefore, when I'm using this component here, I can define my inputs and my outputs, and I have a strict API, and also can do a static syntax check against it, and I will be informed about errors. And this is just a small template, but I can reuse it within the whole application. This, for example, I will transclude the text and can change the icon class for the button. which we can see here. And the button interface itself, the implementation of it, looks like this. We implement it as a component. Here we define the icon class, a loading spinner as well. Like if there is a progress, please display a loading spinner to indicate the user that there is something happening. And also disabling it if the form is invalid. Primary is just a question of the color, like should it be in the primary color or not. And then, we simply have the login text. Finally, that's it. So the rendered version, as you can expect, looks similar. Where we have our iris button and then the template in it. So what is quite nice there, but we are not using it because we found some issues where you can do this by rendering it as a shadow component as well, which means that the button itself or the shadow component would be completely isolated. You define some CSS styles there, for example, for this button. Let's just take, for example, the button spinner, and you want to use the same span element, I don't know, somewhere else on the page. This would mean when you're doing it as a web component that it has no effect on the rest of the page. So rendering a component as a web component is important. Like there are some parts and some points where it makes sense, but there are also some points where it makes no sense. And Angular 2 is heavily, the Angular 2 components are heavily depending and getting the advantages of web components, but you still have the options like to enable it, disable it, or just mock it. Not mock it, it's like, polyfill it for browsers which are not supporting it. And this was one of our learnings, like we were totally happy about using web components and adding styles directly to our components. I will show you something. Login form. Oh, sorry. Yeah, in Angular 2 you have the option to define the styles as well directly in the components. I think it's called styles, where you define your inline array with the styles, or styles URL. I think that's URL, where you pass an array with your, I don't know, style CSS. And so on. So Angular cares about loading those styles. And when you enable, for example, the rendering that it should be rendered as a web component, the styles, the style definitions, would only affect the component itself. So this was one of our learnings, like why we defined our styles outside of the component, because of this, of the style reusability. So we are using Sess in this case, and we are using BEM, which should provide like a more maintainable option in order to care and maintain your styles as well, and not adding that much importance and override some other styles. We try to handle this with the BEM approach. I want to switch back. Yes.
The bootstrap CSS is in this BEM style as well, or you have two different approaches?
The bootstrap style is not there. This was also a question. I think it's not that Angular 2 related, but we are using only the grid system of bootstrap, nothing else. Because bootstrap brings some advantages, but maybe you only use 2% of it, or 5 or 10%, but a lot of payload which you're not using.
But your class names have two different styles, the bootstrap style and your custom BEM style.
What do you mean with that, bootstrap?
That you have in the HTML document, you have class names.
Mm-hmm.
And you use this BEM style with underscores, and you have the normal bootstrap style with dashes.
Yeah, some parts were taken over, and I think these were definitions, for example, for the icons. We use also icon moon, I think, or Glyphicon. I don't know which bootstrap is using.
Glyphicon.
Yeah. So there are some dependencies to them. Okay, let's go to our next thing, which we already saw. This was the handling of HTTP calls in Angular 2. So in Angular 1 it was pretty easy, and where we struggled around a lot around with it was like how to just log in, do a post request, get back a token, and pass this token to each request. So there were some solutions provided, like for doing auth2, I think it's the standard auth2 authentication, which is just an add-on to edit, where you add your token, but this token has different parts included. But we simply needed a stupid token, like a string of a length of, I don't know, it has how many length, how was the length, but just pass it on each request to the server. And this was where we just get inspiration from this library and added it to the application. So Angular 2 itself provides the HTTP module. You can inject it, use it, and that's it. But it was hard to find out like how to add this to the HTTP module. And our solution, and I think if you have some other solutions, please ping me, I would be happy to improve this. Our solution was like to override it with the custom HTTP auth class, where we define in our constructor, which is provided on the bootstrap phase, we provide the config where we define, please use this name as a header name, use this value or this function in order to get back the value. And here we can see private HTTP. Yeah, we are doing all this magic stuff. And we also added here some interceptors, for example, for catching 403 errors or 404, not 404s, 401 errors, if the user is not allowed, or if the token is still invalid, please redirect him or do anything with him. So here, for example, we are checking the requests, and if there is a 403, just redirect the user to the logout page. Here we have our request helper, where we say on each request, this is just a preparation, add this custom type. This is also, also a smaller pitfall. Like setting up Angular 2 works out that easy, but interacting with it, for example, our REST API accepts JSON, which is sent in the body, in the request body, and therefore you have to define which request, which content type you send to the server. Otherwise, or this is also depending on which backend are you using, but otherwise the backend will not check that this is JSON. It will interpret it as text or something other. But anyway, it's needed to explicitly add the content type on each post request, for example, in order to define, hey, I'm sending JSON right now to you, and not stupid, simple text. This is also happening in the custom HTTP component class, in this case, where we say on each request, please add this header.
I have a short question.
Yes.
Is it now possible to set stupid simple text requests, or
In this case, you have to implement it. In our case, we didn't have the case,
okay.
So we added it in general. But you also can make it more configurable,
mm-hmm.
where you define it as a flag or just pass the header on each request. So you still have the possibility to add those header options on each request. But imagine if you have, I don't know, 20, 30 API endpoints, you have to do it 20 or 30 times. So that was the reason why we override the out-of-the-box HTML module. And here you can see the different methods, which are simply overwritten. So we used our own thing and depending just on Angular 2's HTTP module and add some customized stuff.
Just a short question for the JSON REST API part. I didn't try it on Angular 2 yet, but on Angular 1 I had a problem when I was consuming a REST API from a different, it's the same domain but I have a different port in the end, and it says cross-port attack, cross-domain attack.
Yeah, the question. The question was for all which are sitting in the background, was like doing a REST API call on the same server with the same domain but on a different point.
Port.
Port. And therefore the cores are getting affected. Like the server, you can define like which requests are accepted. You can whitelisting or blacklisting different URLs, but in this case you have to define on the different port like requests from this referrer are allowed. So this is just a server thing. And it's restricted normally pretty hard by default from all the server, like if it's, I don't know, the different servers, Apache or some other stuff. But this is just a server thing. Okay. Another important thing, like as our Angular 1 application, I will switch to the Angular 1 application here as well. And we'll take the login component. In Angular 1 we did the approach like we defined per module, and a module in this case is a page. We defined one entry point, like the index.ts, where we define our Angular module. So Angular was only used there in the index files where we define the directive called login container. And then we say it's new login container directive, which is just an ES6 class. We just do the referencing. This is the login container directive, which extends the base directive, which holds all those Angular 1 directive options and some default options here. For example, restricted to elements and all this stuff. And we returned or exported in this case only the module's name. And in our app.ts, we required all those modules and defined it here in an array, like full with drinks, full with the module name. And it was easy to bootstrap the application without rewriting. For example, if you change the module name, you have to rewrite it here and on all dependencies. So that's how we handled like a looser coupling or a better maintainability. So if I want to rename my login module, I just have to rename it here. And that's it. In Angular 2 you don't have some pitfalls like this because, as you know, it is written in TypeScript, and refactoring or rewriting something in TypeScript is quite easy. So if you're or if you have or do Java development, you will know it how easy it is to refactor, I don't know, some classes, methods, properties, types and all this case. And this is also the thing with Angular or with TypeScript itself, and yeah, especially with Angular 2, because in Angular 2, as we saw in some components, let me take the login component and let's take a look at the login form. So as you can see here, this is just my HTML, and the Angular 2 or TypeScript support in all the IDEs, for example Visual Studio Code from Microsoft, or WebStorm, or okay, PHP Storm and IntelliJ IDEs are a bit behind, but WebStorm is pretty good and have a small gap between the implementations of TypeScript and their IDE support. For example, I define here my login form component, I'm pressing command and click on it, and I'm, whoops, in the login form. It's the same with the loginform.html. And here, for example, I have this new annotation, and I'm saying, if the form is getting submitted, then call the authenticate method. So the Angular 1 way, we can try it. It's in the login form template, where we do this, yeah, on an ng click. For example, when I want to go to this vm.login method, I have to know, okay, this is the login form template, so I have to go to the login form directive. Where should be those login methods? I'm pretty sure that everybody knows the situations. So, in Angular 2, it's similar, but faster. I'm here. It's just, yeah, the IDE support is so amazing. Like, I went through from the template to the method itself. So later on, as it's so predictable, there will be also static linting implemented, where you get notified, for example. Let's see if it works already. I will rename this and go into the login form HTML. Oh yeah, here I see unreserved function or method name authenticate. So in Angular 1, I can try this as well. I'm just renaming the login method, going into the template, and nothing happens. So I'm just compiling it, going to the browser, click on it, and I'm wondering like, what's happening? Why is this not working? In Angular 2,
but it was working before.
It was working before?
Yeah, like you because it already, like Angular 1 already recognized that it's an unused function when you renamed it. And if you rename it as login, it just finds multiple, like it's not that precise.
Yeah, it's like the old JavaScript way, it should work like here when I press command and click on it. Okay, I have different login functions in my protractor configuration or in the logic spec. So I still have to think more about it instead of just clicking on it. And this is also nice, like when it comes to loginform.ts, to refactoring. I easily can refactor this, like just for proof. I'm here in the authenticate method. We'll go to it and we'll rename it to authenticate me. And whoop, it's refactored here as well. So you have a lot of automatization included, which makes it more predictable and also more maintainability in the future, because it gets used all the things of TypeScript and of Angular 2 especially for the new syntax. Any questions so far? No? Perfect.
Where are your tests?
I waited for it. So our tests are close to where we defined it. For example, no, our end-to-end tests are in a separate folder outside of the structure. And we have some tests, I don't know, Let's take a look on the. Yeah, we have here, for example, one service which handles the position of a date picker, for example, or of a tooltip. If it's above or under an element, and the tests are included there as well. So we are using Hammer as a test runner, therefore, and the tests are also written in TypeScript, which is quite easy and simple. So this is looking similar to Angular 1, like we have a for each where we check our class which we want to test. In this case we have just two dependencies and we don't want to mock them because it's the document object and the window object, and then we run through our tests and testing all those fancy HTML interaction, when is what positioned. Well, we have other tests. These are other specs, like specs from the project related. And the end-to-end tests are in a separate folder. For example, let's go to the login spec. And this looks pretty similar. Like we are using Protractor for it with all the nice helpers in order to access the different elements and also handle all the Angular 2 Bootstrap customized things, like in order to notify, for example, the test runner when the application is bootstrapped and all this stuff. So here is just a end-to-end test for demonstration, like checking a title, which is quite easy, or going to a more detailed one, the date picker tests. Before all, open the login page, navigate to this page, and then test the date picker. We want to clear the local storage and all this stuff, and you see a more longer end-to-end test. So the end-to-end tests are not complex because it's just do this action and check if the result is happening. And the tests itself are also included. Not class name. In our package JSON, where we have, on the one hand we defined our own scripts, we on the other hand we took over about some existing scripts from the Angular 2 WebKit starter package, and I can run my end-to-end tests, testing against or running 100% locally or testing against a different API. Here we can handle this, or I know, doing the builds for production, doing a build for the different environments, run the tests in watch mode, and all this stuff. Okay, and now back to the start. Like, what were the steps? The migration of the basic, with these pitfalls, for example, the login and the REST API handling, this consumed the most of the time. Like, what was the first step in this case? It was, as we used TypeScript before as well, so we had just exchanged the application part by part, starting by the main entry point, because we want to go one step there. For example, this was the login, and all this login-related stuff, sending all those data to the servers and implementing the REST APIs. Those were just rewriting your Angular 1 code into Angular 2, which can be done automatically as well with a search and replace. For example, when we take the loginform.html, and in the Angular 1 project it's the same. And here we see the identical implementation of display this error message when there is an invalid request. This is the Angular 1 version. Like here we have this old syntax, ng-if. In Angular 2 it looks like this. Do we have here something else? Yeah, we did some customized implementations, and this is also a good start to get experience with Angular 2. It's like, yeah, just starting with dumb components and trying to get more feeling for the usage of Angular 2. So the first thing was like implementing the login and the setup for Angular 2. Therefore, we took over the Webpack starter kit and then rewriting the templates. And therefore, you find a good documentation on the Angular page, like what have changed. For example, all this new syntax changes. Or for example, we have the different brackets there. This is listening to the submit event. This is defining and interacting with the form helper in this case, where we pass some data there. If we want to have a two-way data binding, it looks different. It's just learning the new syntax, and that's it. The most easiest part of it was like rewriting all the directives, all the custom directives in Angular 1, because in Angular 2 you only have components. The components looks like this. Here, for example, we define the selector, have a template, and whoop, that's it. In Angular 1, this was a bit more tricky. So here we defined our component. Let's take the login form directive, where we had, in this case, the base directive, and here we defined the template and the controller for it. So as you can see here, the migration was just removing this one and adding the component annotation, defining the selector, defining the inputs and outputs of the object. And another important part there is like defining all the inputs and outputs and dependencies. For example, the login page. Here we've defined one dependency, and this is the iris button. Without this, it would look like this, just login, and that's it. So in Angular 2, I have two possibilities, like defining the dependencies here directly, or defining them as a global dependency on the bootstrap, on the bootstrap method. For example, I've defined all the form helpers, all the HTTP dependencies, and so on. So right now I re-added the iris directive button, and here it is. So what I want you to say is, like, it makes it more explicit, like, where we have dependencies. It sounds at the first moment like, yeah, I have to write more code, but in the end, it will result in more predictability, like, you know how your components will react, which dependencies they have. You can easily exchange them when you want to test them, implement your own mocks, and so on.
But it's not just that. So with this possibility, you can also do the limitation when you need to do the third-party API. You have basically a limitation which part of the system you want to provide to the partners, because you have basically injection on component level.
Yes, that's another good thing. The last main concern, which we will have, a pitfall in this case, is like about the routing. Like, routing in Angular looks like pretty easy. When we take a look at the main.ts file, it's just those stupid configurations. But here you have also the possibility from the scratch or implemented without adding some other vendors, like loading them asynchronous. And let's take a look here. You can also define some child routes, which is indicated by those three dots. So for example, we have a pricing/ID, pricing/edit, whatever. And those child routes can be defined in the pricing component in this case, where we can see the route config as well. So if it's just slash pricing, as we saw before, it uses the assessment table to render. And if it's using prices slash cargo slash ID, it uses the herd detail component. And another thing where I want to hand over to Igor is like when you define them to load the routes asynchronous.
Yeah. Okay, regarding the asynchronous loading, it's a bit tricky because since your system since your system is loading the components asynchronously, because you don't want to load the complete application with the bootstrap, because if you have a big application, it could, I don't know, 10 megabytes could take a while to download, and you don't want to do that. And in this manner, you won't load everything asynchronously. This means when you have, basically, if you have chances, so top level, you have, for example, authentication, then you have right navigation, then you have top bar, then you have page in a page, and all these child routes are registered asynchronously because they are asynchronously loaded in the system, all those files. And with the problem of it is basically that the Angular doesn't know at the time basically which system and which route it should provide, because it's asynchronously put it in the system. And then there is a way how to solve it. One of the ways is basically, that's why they are refactoring this, by the way, because they completely refactored in RC version. They are allowing now interpolation as a string, and then basically you can, the system will know when it has to load and when it has to land. So the way how I solve it with the current version, which I have to upgrade to the newest version because it's now out of the box, is basically that when I land to some route, I always have to merge the route. So because the header part, actually the route itself, the route itself, it's already defined. And then each time when you load part of the child component, you have to notify the router, actually not the router, the navigation handler, that it has to land to this route. And you're doing basically this by event propagation, but you should not, one thing what I had to carry and be careful is that I don't trigger repaint again, because this could happen. And the other tricky part which I had is, because all these child routes we have, is also that the router itself, it's injectable in the basically component where you have route configuration. And because, for example, if you have a navigation which is on the left side, and you want this not to be painted all the time, because so you don't want that left side or a top bar it's painted, because you have navigation, and on each click you don't want that this flash, it's not good user experience. And basically, in order to connect all these routes, I had to expose all the routers which I have, which are, because they are injected and basically constructed on each component where you have the route config. I had to create one central service when Angular was constructing this component, I had to share the state of this router, and then I have state of all routers, and I can generate this route anywhere in a system, because on the problem is that when you have a tree, in the left side of the tree you don't have access to the right side of the tree of the router, so that's the problem, and then you have to expose it. One tricky part is then that you have to, when you destroy, you have to clear all the references, otherwise you will have the error leaks.
Okay, some common sentences in order to migrate So we choose the total migration because we were in a quite initial state and it was quite easy. We also have some other applications where we are currently in the migration, where we took part of the possibility to using running Angular 1 and Angular 2 at the same time. So there is still this library called ng-forward, which just gives you the possibility to run Angular 1 and Angular 2 in the same application and try to migrate part by part of it. So this gives you the possibility just to try it out. It should be used not usually on those front-end performance critical pages, because it adds a lot of payload on your requests as well, like you're loading Angular 2, Angular 1, and ng-forward and some other dependencies. But in general, using it, for example, on a single page application which is hidden in the, behind the login, you have the possibility to play around with Angular 2 and start by choosing one component, do it in Angular 2, getting some experience doing the next component or the next page with it, and go step by step with it. So at one point you can throw away Angular 1, but you still have the possibility to use Angular 1 and 2 in parallel. And also exchange data. For example, your Angular 1 application gets used of two-way data binding. You can pass this data to your Angular 2 component as well. And on the other side, it works as well. And there is another method or framework, I think, I don't know the name, may some of you know it, where you write your Angular 1 code in the Angular 2 style. So the style itself looks like you're doing Angular 2, but it's getting just compiled down to Angular 1, which gives you the possibility just to exchange it, and that's it, with some limitations. So I heard of those two possibilities, the first one we are using. The second one sounds a bit dirty, like you're writing, or you try to write Angular 2, but in general it gets transpiled to Angular 1. You can come now and say, TypeScript is doing the same, like you're writing something fancy and it gets compiled. But in this case I would think about the gap, like if there is a new release you want to upgrade and this project is not maintained anymore, then you have a huge problem, because it's not that popular, but it's getting promoted, I don't know why. But I would definitely recommend you to use ng-forward, which is provided to you by the Angular team. And if you're thinking about upgrading, but you don't, or you want to upgrade but you can't because you're not allowed, or not right now, or you have to wait, the current process or direction which Angular 1 is going is like making the gap closer between Angular 1 and Angular 2. And one of the most important changes, or most visible changes, therefore, were, for example, the component definition in the last, I think it was the last release of Angular 1. So we had another conversation in the break where the question blocked up about the maintainability or about the support for Angular 1, because Angular 2 is that fancy and that hype right now. So the Angular team takes as an indicator the requests on the Angular 1 repository and documentation page and some other resources compared to the Angular 2 version. So right now Angular 1, I can't remember on the numbers exactly, but it was like about 1.3 million users going to the Angular 1 version, and Angular 2 is about 200 to 300,000. So Angular 1 is still very popular, and we'll definitely get updates and upgrades in the next years. And this is the indicator, which is quite a nice and just logical base for if there is no access anymore to my documentation page or repositories, I think there is no need. Any questions so far from you? Torsten.
Carsten, sorry.
Your specs actually were in ES5, JavaScript, pure JavaScript. Why not TypeScript?
Why not TypeScript?
Why would I write two different languages to in the same project?
Because this is a protractor thing. Our end-to-end tests, we just run them with Protractor, and the answer is we didn't find the way like how we can add the TypeScript transpiling within a within a Protractor configuration. And the end-to-end tests, for example, we can add this transpilation step quite easily. It's well documented, and we didn't find the solution right now. That's the reason why we are using plain old ES5 there and not TypeScript or ES6.
But I think that you can maybe accomplish it with System.js. If you actually do it this on the fly, it will be a bit slower for the first load, but you will be able to accomplish it.
With System.js, yeah, and then you have the transpiler.
Yeah, it's done on the fly, and it would work technically.
Good hint. Any other questions?
Did you have any filters which you had to convert to pipes?
This is quite easily. You have Angular 2 is based on TypeScript, and then you have just to implement the filter interface, which is just one method which you have to implement, but it's a no-brainer. Like migrating Angular 1 filters to Angular 2 filters. Did I get the question right?
Yeah, probably, but I've just watched some IndieCon videos, and from what I learned there, you now have to basically replace references because Angular 2's new change detection works on that. So the old simple filtering does no longer work if you just manipulate, for example, the list you're filtering on also.
In this case, yes, but you can use the different implementations of the async pipes, for example, which we saw, and there were, a filter in Angular 2 is not just a filter as it was in Angular 1. In Angular 2, it's called a pipe, and you can do even more instead of filtering. As we saw, like, when subscribing for asynchronous options, for example, or on observers, you have to add the async function, which does nothing more than just listening till it receives something, or till the stream gets closed, and then it's like it cuts the connection, and that's it. And you define it more explicitly with these pipes in Angular 2.
But I think the only difference is actually that between the Angular 2 pipes and the filters in Angular 1. I mean, when you take a look, both are transpired to some function. But in Angular 2, they are accepting the way that they can accept asynchronous functions. And that's the difference. Because at the end, in Angular 1, filters are just a function which is executed.
Yeah. No, my question revolved more about the when you change the object to get passed in Angular 1, then Angular will digest and will get that, and Angular 2 does something different to that.
But you can also pass it. I mean, even in Angular 2, you can pass arguments if you need it to the filter, to the pipe. You are able to do.
Yeah, sure.
Yeah. With you guys is using Angular 1 right now and thinks about upgrading. And why? Because there is always like the new technology, I want to use this fancy stuff, but I'd be more interested in why do you want to upgrade? Which benefits you want to get used of?
In case of a simple project, it's also a learning experience, because there were some things I didn't like very much on Angular 1, and I now want to see if it works better on Angular 2 or something. But just for small projects and things, and not for really new things.
For playing around with it.
Yeah, exactly.
What are the other reasons?
better structure, maybe, and future proof. So, I'm at the beginning of a project, and this seems like maybe a more logical step to onboard other people already on Angular too.
So initially is a proof of concept or something like this, and then as a decision maker, yes or no.
Yeah.
What are your reasons?
Frankly, I don't do many stuff on front end, but mostly on back end. But if I were to decide, my arguments for Angular 2 would be first this the very idea of the a component versus different sort of stuff in Angular 1. Because this is actually how I understand the program, is that it's built of small blocks that can be composed. And then again composed, and then again composed.
Yes.
And second would be TypeScript. But well, you can probably simply migrate to TypeScript, but it would be way. And third, it's not true for in case of your application. But probably at some point you can use UI components from Angular team. I believe they are cool.
Yeah, material design. You
But I'm not. You know, I'm not hipster, so it's not about design, but about how they are designed in terms of software, like you say. Cool API and stuff like that.
I know what you mean.
Yeah.
But also this component idea. I mean, you can have isolation, which you don't have.
Yeah.
But isn't that the same like there the in Angular 1 directive space?
Yes.
No.
In Angular 1.5, you have components which are.
Yeah. This is going. This is now a logical step to make the gap closer between version 1 and version 2, but. When you compare, for example, the history one time ago with Angular 1, which, what was your main reason to get used of Angular 1? Mine was, for example, those fancy two-way data binding. This was pretty cool, but after a huge project experience, two-way data binding is bullshit, like it breaks you the neck.
Yeah.
You want to have more prediction and predictability in order to get application which you trust, and I think this direction is going closer to the version 2 in order to make people's life easier in order to jump from 1 to 2, and I'm pretty sure, and those are the next steps, like for version 1, like making that gap closer, and as well providing security fixes, bug fixes, performance improvements and all this stuff. But the history of Angular 1 is going to the component way.
And currently on the enterprise level, considering all the changes in the that they're going through Angular 2, is it worth it on an enterprise level to develop something with Angular 2 at the moment? Rather than with Angular 1, which is stable and you know it's not going to change in the next week?
I think we started with beta 7. We did not upgrade immediately after a new beta was released. We want to take a look, okay, what's the experience with the others? And just waited, and then we upgraded step by step. So as smaller your application is, and as simpler, as less effort you have. But if you're heavily using routing, for example, you will not be happy like with the latest upgrades to RC1. And there were some major changes, like some renamings of ng-if to the snake, I think it's the snake case version, like ng-if but without the minus, and all the internal directives, they were prefixed, I think, in one of the betas with ng, but now this is removed. And there were a lot of major changes, and the API was quite stable, like there were not that hard changes anymore. And with the latest router changes, they do also some bug fixes with it, and it's interesting when you upgrade, like getting the background information why they changed it. So it's quite interesting as well, and yeah, it's heavier and bigger your application is more time you have to invest. But right now RC1 is out, and from my point of view it's quite okay to use it. I would consider using it on just critical applications, like where the user interact directly, or like e-commerce application. Like our use case is like behind the login, like more in internal single page application, so we can play around with it. A bigger payload size makes not that big impact, and those are also some main points from the current roadmap of the Angular 2 guys, or of the Angular guys. One of them is like reducing the payload size by using tree shading and other fancy stuff, and I think the main goal is like a Hello World application which has a size of 10 kilobytes in the build version without gzip. Reducing the payload size and adding a stuff of pre-compile it. Like you can imagine you build your application and your syntax, for example ng-if, gets translated or compiled to the native DOM version of it. So you can save, or you don't need a lot of boilerplate code, which is needed therefore, which results in an even better performance therefore. Another target, it's not the Angular team itself, but it's called Angular Universal, which cares about the different rendering opportunities. For example, it's easy to use it in your browser, but Angular 2 works this way. Like you have your application layer, which produces your view tree, and this view tree is passed to the view layer. This can be the browser itself, or it can easily be exchanged, for example, your view is generated by your node server, or they are talking with other language guys as well, like pre-rendering an Angular 2 application with PHP or with Java or with the Perl or whatever you're using. So this is the one thing, and as you can it's a logical plus calculation. They are also adding rendering or transpiling some stuff to the native mobile platforms,
native,
for example,
script, yeah.
Yeah, native script, which transpiles or renders your application as much as possible on the native base of your application of iOS, Android, I think Windows, they already added Windows, isn't it? Windows, yes, and there is Ionic, which gets used of that heavily, like writing your application, which is get transpiled into the native versions of your target platforms. Native script, TypeScript, Ionic, not TypeScript, Ionic, and there are some other things which they still want to investigate in order to make pre-rendering so much easier compared to Angular 1.
And this is possible because of this special syntax of the template.
The syntax itself and the application, like the application layer just produces your view tree, and the view tree is getting processed by the different, you can easily exchange your view layer of the application, which also goes into the native direction. Like you can do, I don't know, do your desktop application in Angular 2, or something like that. Like you can export it wherever you want, and that's quite easily compared to Angular 1, for example, using pre-render IO or different other tools. Yeah, that's...
So basically, Angular is becoming React.
No.
I can't.
Come on.
No, Angular 2.
Not that bad.
It's not that bad. Like, what I really liked about the Angular team when they started the new version, like, they were open-minded and just talk with the other guys, like they talk with the React guys, they are working that close with the Microsoft TypeScript guys, they're working close with
Netflix
is Rx in this case, with the Ionic guys, the TypeScript guys, and all the different implementations, and also Microsoft as well for RxJS, which is also heavily improved by the Netflix guys and some other guys. So they try to pick up the best of it, put it in Angular 2, and that's it. That's it. It's the simple version. The more detailed version is like they try to go this approach to provide it modularly as well. For example, using, I don't know, the different layers of it. You can do it, include it in your current application, and that's it. So it's quite easy and modular, set it up, instead of having just angular.js and you have everything included. There were also some additions, for example, for testing, for I don't know what else.
The handy part of it is actually what I really like is the just one switch, and you are able to put your data processing in other it's not a thread, but it's simulation, because it's not working in the same thread like UI thread. So, and this would be possible by just configuration.
So unloading application logic in our worker.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yes.
The data processing, which is the most basically cause.
Yeah.
And which just returns your HTML, just exchange it, and that's it.
Mm-hmm.
And that's an important performance improvement.
Yeah, that's
unbelievable.
That's even React doesn't have that.
Any other questions?
Didn't you forget to commit and push?
Yes. No, I just did some modifications in order to, I don't know, remove the brand and rename some dummy data, because it should be not that visible.
Keep pushing.
Force.
Yeah, force push right now.
Two more beers. And then
that's the first one today.
Then take the second fork.
Anything else? Otherwise I will ask you more things. There is no reaction. So guys, please tell me what are your expectations on the Angular meetup, or on the meetup in general. What do you want? What do you want to get? Is it like the talk option, like listening to talks? Is it like we also provided some get your hands dirty meetups as well?
Workshops.
What we also did was a kind of Stammtisch, but the no-show rate was like, I don't know, 30 guys said, hey, I will come, but there were just
I can say that for now, at least, I don't like the idea of a workshop, because on a workshop or on a micro hackathon, you can do things quick and dirty.
Mm-hmm.
But what I'm interested in is to know what are best practices, what the best practices are. So to have different folks share the experience of different decisions.
Mm-hmm.
We've spoken about using different approaches to RxJS.
Different approaches, and I think also the different experience levels, like there are the beginners and there are the experts which want to get that in deep knowledge. Other wishes, or is everybody happy with that format?
I
I like this format where, like today, you get like the cherry of the ice from the interesting topics that are, let's say, interesting for the majority, and at the same time synthesized in a like a lecture or the slides that are like half to 1 hour. So that's really nice because you get the latest news, let's say, and in an easy way. So you don't have to dig down. You have somebody in front who is an expert and can answer your questions, give you like nice information that otherwise you spend quite a lot of time if you do it yourself. So that's quite valuable for me.
Cool. Can you like it?
I always appreciate hands-on lectures about different topics. I don't consider myself an expert, I'm just getting used to the stuff. I started with Angular 2 in the morning, this morning, and I was shocked there's no JavaScript anymore.
Just TypeScript, yeah?
Just TypeScript is JavaScript now, but you just don't know. Because ECMAScript 6 is pretty much it without the static analysis. Mm-hmm.
I used to work with Backbone and stuff like this, and it's completely different.
Yeah, but that's Backbone.
Any other options, feedbacks? Otherwise, I have to agree that you like this format and we'll continue.
Who is interested in giving a talk?
That's the last question. But before, I just wanted to answer, like, we had, I think it was the last meetup, right? Where we had this head-on sessions, they get your hands dirty. This was, from my point of view, quite nice. How did you like it?
So I'm biased, so...
Okay. It was like we had three different topics. One was RxJS, which was facilitated by you.
Yeah.
One was like getting into Angular 2 like from the beginning on, and we had the third one, which was, I can't remember, with three different topics, and we had a maximum number of attendees of, I think it was 25 people, so it was quite a small round, and this kind of workshop, and we sit together I think 3 hours or something like that and just played around in the small groups and just interacted, and hey, I'm bored now with this, I'm a pro right now, I will switch to the RX topic and all this stuff. So how does this sound for you?
Will this work for bigger groups?
It will not. That's the disadvantage or the limitation. It will definitely not work for bigger groups, like groups for 20 to 25, maybe 30 people at max. It will work, but as bigger as it gets, like you can't do it with 100 people, or you have that many topics, and it will just confuse, I think.
You can have multiple groups for the same topic, that's fine.
That's a good idea as well.
Yeah, but then you have you still need a kind of guy who knows more. You need,
Well, so perhaps it helps, but I think there's the internet.
But then, in that case, then you don't need anyone.
You don't need a group, therefore,
If you're disciplined,
no,
just
you
sit down at home
and get together with people. I think that's still better.
Yeah, I think he's right.
Okay, last question, who wants to be a speaker and talk about his pitfalls, projects, whatever,
learning
one of
pains.
The next meetups, and also about the pains, so Jacob is one of our famous speakers.
I like pains.
Igor,
if you need
some
pains,
talks
just
as well.
I can give a next stop as well.
Okay, we have one, so we need three, otherwise we can't go. Number two, number three. Now, otherwise, if you know someone, if you do want to give a talk, just ping one of the meetup organizers and we will arrange it. Because right now, the next meetup is depending on the next speakers. Like, doing a meetup with one speaker
it doesn't count. So we need at least two or three speakers for one of the next meetups. And that's also the reason for the irregularity of our meetups. But there is one announcement. In the end of June, we will have a kind of workshop where we got some guys directly from Telerik, which are doing a native script workshop. So who is interested into doing mobile development with native script, stay tuned. We'll announce, I don't know, 2 or 3 weeks in advance, and grab your RSVP fast, because usually the meetups are totally booked out within half day.
I have one question. What would be most interested for you to hear? So the transition from Angular 1 to Angular 2, or differences, or just the learning curve of Angular 2, or basically what is the key pain points which you have currently in application if you are currently working with Angular 1 or 2?
Personally, I played a bit with two, and not sure if it's still, if it's not obsolete, but there were some issues with router, but it was router.
There still is, but
it was as far as I know significantly refactored, so
yeah.
It probably has gone. I'm not sure.
Yeah, there is a big change which I will just face to refactor the current application. I mean, I can speak about it, but there is a good reason why they did it. I mean, so. But in general, what kind of level would you like to hear? Because I don't know which kind of levels basically are in the groups. So are you working? Who's working daily on the Angular 1 or 2? Raise your hand. Okay.
Sometimes. I think both topics are interesting, especially now when there is this transition.
Yeah.
So on the first hand is what's coming, because there are still changes ongoing, and this means this interesting topic.
Yeah.
Then, once we are out of beta, then also interesting is the next topic for migration, because slowly people will start looking towards this.
Yeah.
Now maybe not, because we still have some period of maintenance, but a couple of months after going out of beta and adoption rate increase, then definitely we will start thinking, okay, when this goes out of support. And once this starts happening, then we definitely need to migrate. So this is the topic that is also very interesting. I think both are more or less equal interest at this point of time.
I think you can make some surveys on meetup.com, if it's possible there.
That's the plan, and also, like, what's the considering of the organizers is making the whole process more clear and more transparent. And this would result, like, we will set up a GitHub repository, not just for code, but just for the issues, and also to, hold down the latest speeches, doing proposals, announcing something, and make it more transparent and clear.
Yeah, instead of GitHub. Topic that maybe would be interesting for the group, especially if not everybody is on a high professional level, are best practices. I think this is something that is always good to know, and especially when it's introduced by somebody who is boiling in the deep waters. So good practices and best practices, they are always actual, I think.
Good practices, best practices, worst practices.
worst practices.
And tooling, I think tooling is quite interesting as well.
Just make sure you don't drink too much beer and mess up.
Which comes in which category.
I mean, I also, when I started working with Angular 2, I also ran in one pitfall regarding the performance. But it's just because we misunderstood something, and I also can speak about how to avoid these pitfalls.
Yeah, we can learn quite a lot from such experiences, because
And it's mainly in the forms, and because forms are two-way data binding, and what you have to be basically careful when you have multiple elements which are using the validations and when they're shared and stuff like that.
Okay, I see some bored faces. Guys, it was a pleasure. Have a nice weekend.